Thank you. Buenos días, estudiantes de pregrado y de posgrado, sobre todo a los de neurociencias y a los que han recibido el housing. Afortunadamente, este apoyo nos brinda la Society for Neuroscience, and Diane is our president. Voy a leer un poquito que sepan de ella. Creo que es la doctora Diane Lipscomb, actual presidenta de la Society for Neuroscience, es profesora en Neuroscience de la Brown University. Diane es president de la sociedad, bueno, desde Neurociencias, desde el año pasado, 2018. La doctora Lipscomb obtuvo su doctorado en la universidad, en el University College of London en 1986, y después de dos estancias postdoctorales en las universidades Yale y Stanford, se unió al equipo académico de Brown en 1990 y al Departamento de Neurociencias en 1993. La doctora Lipscomb fue elegida como miembro de la American Association for the Advancement of Science en 2013 y ha cumplido ha realizado varios trabajos dentro de la Society for Neuroscience y la National Institute of Health. La doctora Lipscomb y su equipo de laboratorio investigan el papel de los canales del ion de voltaje en la función de neuronas. Incluyen cómo son regulados y modulados. Ella estudia cómo pueden mediar las señales de dolor agudo y crónico y su importancia potencial en la patofisiología de enfermedades y desórdenes. A través de colaboraciones, el equipo de la doctora Lipscomb estudia las etapas tempranas de esclerosis lateral amiloide en modelo de animales y está desarrollando herramientas moleculares nuevas para regular la actividad. Le damos un fuerte aplauso a la doctora Gaña. Además de la doctora Dayan y su servidora, Rosalinda Guevara, que soy la presidenta actual de capítulo, nos acompañan, de mi lado derecho la doctora Carolina Escobar, que es la vicepresidenta del capítulo. A mi mano izquierda se encuentra el doctor David Centurión, que es el tesorero secretario del capítulo, y también nos acompaña la doctora Luisa Rocha, que fue expresidente del capítulo. Un fuerte abrazo para todos. Ahora sí.
Okay, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes? Buenos dias. That's it. No more Spanish. I'm very sorry. It's fun to be here. I've had a great time. I've been in Mexico. This is my first visit to Mexico. I know. How did that happen? I don't know. And it's been really fun. Everyone has been great, fantastic science going on. I'm really impressed. I was in Querétaro for a few days and now here, and just very impressed. Great hosts. Everyone is so friendly. So thank you all for being here at a very early time in the morning. Maybe not for you, but 9 a.m. So thank you to the chapter leadership for the invitation to be here. It's really a great honor. Thank you all for being here. And I know that there are some students who heard my talk. Oh, I know that there are many students here, so great. I love to talk to students. And some heard my talk yesterday and they have to be here again today because you are awarded fellowships from the Society for Neuroscience. But maybe it's not so bad to hear the same thing twice. I don't know. Yeah, so this is going to be straight science. I'm going to talk about our research, and I would be delighted to take any questions at any time. I don't know what you prefer to do, but you know, if you have a burning question, don't hesitate, because I bet someone else has the same question. Okay, great. So this is work that I will talk about from my own research lab, and I decided to focus on work that was done by three postdoctoral associates who were in my lab over a number of years. And Arturo Andrade is here, and he is from Mexico City. he Simba stuff. And we were there yesterday. So he's a star of the work I will show you. And Javier Lopez Soto, who is from Argentina. And he is currently in my lab. And the work started by Jessica Rengo, who is also from Argentina, from La Plata. And Jessica was Javier's PhD advisor. So there is a theme here that you will understand. And this is really fantastic work that the three of them did. Kristen Webster is also here, who is a graduate student in my lab. Kristen down here in the front. And I do not have time to talk about her work, and I've already apologized several times to her for that. But if you get a chance to talk to Kristen, I'm sure she will tell you about her work. Okay. Let's see. I need the pointer. So let me start. My lab is, for many years, been very interested in the processes by which cells control intracellular calcium levels. Okay. This is the periodic table for my lab. And calcium is at the center of the universe for us. It is also for you too, so regardless of what lab you work in or what organ you study, maybe you're in medical school, everything is controlled by calcium. if there's someone here who doesn't work on a second messenger system or an organ that doesn't have calcium, then you're probably in the wrong room, okay? So my lab is very interested in a class of protein that carries calcium across cell membranes and is particularly important for moving calcium down its concentration gradient into cells in response to activity. So membrane depolarization, okay? All excitable cells. We're gonna be very neuron-centric right now. That's okay, because since I'm the president of the Society for Neuroscience, you will forgive me for that. And so we work on these proteins here, which are voltage-gated calcium ion channels. They are exquisitely good at sensing a change in the membrane voltage and transducing that immediately with no delay into the flow of calcium into the cell. Okay? They're beautiful proteins. And we study them at a number of different levels, but these are single channel recordings that we also do in my lab. You can look at the movement in real time of a single protein. It's very amazing. Okay, so this is a cartoon to really amplify what I just said, which is that calcium, as I said, is at the center of biology, and it controls a number of different cellular processes, muscle contraction, gene expression, cell death, apoptosis, memory formation, neurotransmitter release, control of excitability. Depending on where the calcium signal is inside the cell, then that will determine its function as a second messenger. Because of its tremendous importance for cell function, there are a number of neurotransmitters, endogenous regulators, that control the flow of calcium, and a number of drugs used in the clinic are highly effective at controlling various disorders, and they act to decrease, and in some cases increase, the level of calcium, mostly to decrease. And the most well-known are the dihydropyridines, calcium channel blockers, and they are highly effective at reducing blood pressure in hypertension. And they block a particular class of voltage-gated calcium channels in smooth muscle. Okay. Less well appreciated, but I will amplify this, is that morphine and gabapentin, so drugs that are used as analgesics, also owe at least part of their action to down-regulating the entry of calcium through voltage-gated calcium channels. And I will talk about this actually quite extensively in my presentation. Okay, and again, noted here, there are a large number of disorders that are linked in various ways to dysregulation of cellular calcium, including a number of psychiatric disorders, cardiovascular disorders, and I also mentioned chronic pain, which is an area where somewhat more specifically interested in. Okay, so that's a bit of a background. And here's that beautiful protein that I talked about, which is the voltage-gated ion channel. And this is a large protein, about 250 kilodaltons, a very big gene, and has all of these parts of the protein are critical for sensing a change in membrane voltage. And in the middle of the protein, surrounded by these four major parts of the protein, is the pore, the iron pore, that is highly selective for calcium ions over most other ions. That's quite difficult to do chemically, to be able to select for these discriminate between these small molecules, ions. But calcium flows through and is selected for by about 1,000 to 1 over other cations that are in the solution. So very highly selective pore, calcium ions move through at a very high rate, and almost approaching the rate of diffusion. So these are extremely perfectly tuned proteins for moving calcium very quickly. So there are multiple forms of voltage-gated calcium channels. And in the mammalian nervous systems, there are 10 major genes that encode the core of that protein that I showed you. And they have different, slightly different functions. The basic core is the same. And please ignore all those names, they're not important, unless you're doing an exam, which I don't think you're going to be tested on my lecture. I hope not. the main point is that there are 10 genes, and they're found in different tissue, and they support different cell functions. Okay? And they each have different pharmacological properties, and so there are different toxins that inhibit selectively different forms, and these channels up here are the ones that are inhibited by dihydropyridines that control blood pressure. Okay. I'm going to focus on this gene here, and it encodes this protein here, which I will refer to as 2.2, and the nomenclature is CA is calcium, the V means voltage-gated, and then the numbers correspond to the identity of the gene. Okay. So it makes sense, right, that these would have slightly different properties that are optimized through natural selection to serve a particular cell function. And I like to give one example of this because there are different properties, but this I like to show because I think it's very intuitive when one thinks about, okay, if these are voltage-gated channels, voltage is important for activation, We understand, of course, that the membrane voltage can move from around minus 70 millivolts, minus 75 in some cells, up to maybe plus 30 millivolts and then back down. So the trajectory of an action potential, which would be the largest electrical signal for excitable cells, traverses along this axis here, right? And these different colors are different voltage-gated calcium ion channels encoded by different genes, and you can see that they each have a particular voltage dependence of activation, an activation curve. So this gene here, the 3.1, opens at relatively negative voltages. And this one over here is the skeletal or skeletal muscle calcium channel that controls the contraction of muscles. And so there's a very big range over which these different genes activate. Okay. The gene the protein that I will talk about most is this 2.2, and it is critical for controlling calcium entry into presynaptic terminals to regulate synaptic vesicle fusion and exocytosis. Okay. So this particular gene encodes a protein absolutely critical for release of neurotransmitter at many synapses in the mammalian nervous system. Okay. Great. And to solidify that in your mind with a visual illustration, this is a presynaptic nerve terminal, and this is the protein that we work on mostly. And it's found at presynaptic terminals to regulate release of, in this case, glutamate, because I will show you examples from nociceptors that are sensory neurons that are critical for carrying information about noxious stimuli, very high heat, acid, extreme cold. So a number of different sensory stimuli that are harmful. And so various nociceptors will encode different proteins to respond to those different stimuli. And the one that we work on mostly is the nociceptors whose role is to respond to high heat, so noxious heat, that then when it's picked up by these nociceptors becomes pain. Pain is a perception, okay? You know, but the nociceptors are the first point from the skin, the first point of entry into the central nervous system of that signal that is potentially harmful. Okay, great. The other piece of information I need to tell you about this protein, this calcium channel, is that it is extremely sensitive and extremely responsive to a variety of different neurotransmitters and to drugs. I already introduced that. And so that modulation of the activity of the channel occurs primarily through G-protein coupled receptors, of which there are a huge number. And these are receptors that are critical for detecting information from hormones and from neurotransmitters, and those pathways are co-opted by drugs that we develop to be able to intervene at those points in the pathway, okay? So this is a G-protein-coupled receptor. I'm sure that many of you work on these molecules. And they couple to a different number of downstream proteins, in this case, to the voltage-gated calcium channel. And there's this trimeric G protein complex, G alpha, G beta gamma. And when the agonist binds the receptor, this complex is activated, and the G beta gamma dimer can dissociate from its alpha, bind to the calcium channel, and inhibit the activity, inhibit the gating. Okay? And then the G alpha has another way in which it can inhibit the activity of the calcium channel through a different pathway that is independent of G beta gamma. Okay? And so both these different pathways can inhibit the gating of the calcium channel. I'm going to come back to this, so I want you to kind of hold this image in your mind, because when I talk about splicing, so different forms of the calcium channel that can be generated from one gene, so that I'm going to add another layer of complexity. We have found, Jessica and Arturo and Javier have all worked on this, found that depending on the splice isoform, this pathway is always engaged, but depending on the splice isoform, this may or may not be engaged. Okay? So that splicing, which I will come to, can modify the way in which the G-protein coupled receptors inhibit the channel. Okay? Great. So there are many forms of channels encoded by different genes. And now I'm going to add another layer of diversity, which is that, and I think most of you will know, that it's no longer one gene, one protein, particularly for multi-exon genes, which is the typical gene in our genome. It's one gene, and it could be thousands of proteins that are generated through a process which doesn't have a particularly endearing name, which is called pre-mRNA alternative splicing, alternative pre-mRNA splicing, meaning that at the level of the pre-mRNA, when the gene is transcribed into the full-length pre-mRNA before splicing occurs, there's a lot of processing that goes on, and I'm going to go into that in a lot more detail. But the reason that this is important is because if we are all interested in really digging deep into identifying and understanding signaling in the individual systems that we all work in, shouldn't we want to know the form of the protein that is expressed there, that is serving that particular function? Okay. And so I'm going to show you why that matters for the gene that we work on. But I am quite sure that it is going to matter for all of the processes that you all work on. And also, if one is thinking about therapeutic intervention and drugs and cures and treatments, this definitely matters. Okay? And so, again, as a visual, to introduce to you one example, which I think is visually quite obvious, is, well, 10 genes, isn't that sufficient? Well, obviously not, because there are many, many, many more proteins generated from a single gene. But if you said, give me an example, well, this is a great example to show you why adding layers of different functions into what we already have is 10 genes. You can see here that these activation curves again, these individual genes, I've shown you the average activation curve for these different gene families. But actually, this is made up of a whole family of different activation curves, because there's multiple forms of this particular calcium channel expressed in the mammalian nervous system, right? And so instead of having the cell having available these discrete activation properties, there's this fantastic gradation of different proteins that are available to really fine-tune the cell function, so that there's this wonderful continuum of activation curves from alternative pre-mRNA splicing, from the diversity of proteins that can be generated from a single gene. Okay? All right, and then to broaden it out before I pull back and then just focus on the calcium channel, I do want to really emphasize this is the rule and not the exception, that more than 95% of multi-exon genes are subject to alternative splicing. That's pretty much everything. It's probably that, you know, the other 5% haven't been studied yet. about 10% of gene mutations in the human population are involved in, are located in areas of the gene that disrupt splicing. Again, that's going to be a growing percentage. And about 30% of all diseases where they have been studied in a lot of detail have some defective splicing associated with them. Okay? And that is true for chronic pain, and I will give you the example. And now there are therapies that are being used to correct splicing or to change splicing to adjust for mutations. And a great example, if you're interested in, is to look up the work on spinal muscular atrophy, you know, which is a tremendously important discovery very recently. And for those of you going to the SFN meeting in October, Adrian Craner will be there, and he will be presenting his work on correction of splicing or shifting the splicing pattern to adjust for the disorder of spinal muscular atrophy, which is helping babies, young children, to improve the pathology associated with SMA. This is a very common hereditary disorder affecting, the most common hereditary disorder affecting young children that we know of. So great discoveries by him. Okay, and then another thing that I want to put in your mind, and this is meant to scare us all, which is that these are, it's a little dim, but I just want to, all of these kind of candy-like things are proteins that are involved in splicing, okay? So there is a, you know, hundreds of proteins and RNAs and this massive complex of the spliceosome, which is recruited during pre-mRNA processing in the nucleus of all cells. And I'm going to ignore all of those proteins. because what we have been really focused on is to understand which proteins are specifying the expression of a particular isoform in a particular cell type. So our work has been focused on cell-specific alternative splicing, and the focus of our work has been on those nociceptors that are critical in detecting noxious heat, okay? So this is the more simplified view of the pre-mRNA processing, and I'm introducing alternative splicing. So, you know, there are constitutive exons that have to, the introns have to be excised and the exons have to be spliced together. Constitutive exons are those that are always present in every single protein that is generated from a gene. But there are many exons in these multi-exon genes that are may or may not be included depending on cell type, depending on developmental stage, and that's what we work on. And so you might imagine, here's a tiny piece of a multi-exon gene, just showing three exons here. And this yellow exon may or may not be included depending on tissue type, for example, okay? And so the spliceosome comes along and it detects this and skips this exon, and the mRNA lacks that yellow exon in a particular tissue type, and perhaps in another tissue type or a different point in development in the same cell. There's a protein that's expressed which enhances the inclusion of this exon and allows the spliceosome to recognize this as an exon to include. And so there you can get two different mRNAs producing two different proteins from one gene through this process. The other form of splicing, rather similar, but this is what we this is what I will talk about, is mutually exclusive splicing, where both exons are the same size, so these are actually hard to find because they're identical size, but they encode different sequences, and there are a number of proteins that bind the pre-mRNA that determine either repress or enhance one of the other proteins, and the expression of these proteins can vary, or their activity can vary depending on cell type, okay? But in this mutually exclusive splicing, either this one goes in or this one goes in. And in this fictitious cell here, both RNAs are represented, and in this one, only this downstream exon is represented. And this is the pattern that we find that I will show you data on. So again, to emphasize, The selection of exons that may or may not be included depends on a number of factors: the tissue, cell type, development, activity, and disease state, which is a really important area of investigation. Okay. Now the calcium channel. So now I laid the foundation, and everything that I showed you is going to have relevance to what I'm going to tell you. And I hope that then you'll be able to preempt what I'm about to show next. So now I'm going to move through fairly rapidly through the data, having given you the background to the work. So this is the gene, our beautiful gene. You know, it's like when you look at a photograph of other people's family, it's not very interesting, and it's only interesting to your family. And so this is a member of our family, and I'm really sorry, but when I look at that, I see something very, very meaningful, and I know that you just see these straight lines and colored lines, but I'm going to try and convince you, bring you into the family a little bit, and convince you that this is interesting. So the first thing to note is that, boy, these voltage-gated calcium channels are big proteins, and they have many, many exons, and that makes it actually quite difficult to study, but it makes it so much fun, because you're never done, right? There's just so much going on here. So there's more than 50 exons. These are the vertical bars, and then there are these colored exons, and I think you can already guess, right, that these colored ones may or may not be included, and the black ones are constitutive. Great. Cool. And the way this depiction here shows the exons' relative size, and then the introns are contracted by tenfold, because otherwise the screen wouldn't be big enough to show the length of the introns. Okay? And so within the introns, all these regulatory elements and things, and but most of the intron, we have absolutely no idea what it's doing. I think that you could do quick math, and if you're doing math, you'll realize that there aren't quite enough isoforms here for the exons that I noted, but if there are four different sites that vary, then you have two to the power of four, and you've got 16 different isoforms that could be generated from a single gene, and there are many more, okay? But these are the ones that we know of, and these are the ones that we have studied quite extensively. I will mention that this little exon here, we haven't studied that much, but this actually introduces, so not all forms are functional, so this exon introduces a stop, an early stop, it frame shifts everything, and so the introduction of this exon completely down-regulates the protein and produces non-functional proteins, and that is in fact a mechanism used also in alternative splicing to either turn or turn off or turn on genes, okay? I'm going to talk about functional isoforms and focus over here on this mutually exclusive site. But I think that you can, with these candies stuck on these pictures of ion channels, you can already imagine how many different forms can be generated. Okay. They are not all, like, so the point is that these are not all produced in every cell, okay? A subset of those are produced in each cell. And so we're trying to figure out what subsets, why, and how. Okay. So here's a great example that we've been working on for many, 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 many years. And I will, again, focus on this form. And this was actually like one of those super moments in the lab where we had been tracking through the gene. We knew there were sites of differential splicing, and we knew that that varied across different parts of the nervous system. But this was super exciting for us because this is a site of mutually exclusive splicing I already introduced. And this A exon, we couldn't find in most tissues. This is all part of the central nervous system here, cortex, hypothalamus, cerebellum, midbrain, and spinal cord here. And then here are two ganglia. I know there are many more, but I'm just showing two. Superior cervical ganglia, easy to pull out of rats and mice, so that's why we look at it. And then the dorsal root ganglia. And I think that you can, this is an RT-PCR with exons that it will only, with primers that will only amplify specific exons. And I think that you can see very beautifully here that there's just a single band here for the dorsal root ganglia. And that's expression of that A exon, which appears to be enriched in just the subset of cells. Okay. Well, this is a fantastic part of the nervous system to study. Right, you can get it, you can pull it out, you can study reflexes in the animal to high heat. So this is a great part of the nervous system if one is interested in what's the function, you know, of this particular splicing pattern. So that work was published actually before Arturo was in the lab, yeah. But then more recently, this is unpublished data, and most of what I'm going to show moving on is unpublished data. But this is from Javier's experiment. And so previous to being able to generate knock-in mice and to put in fluorescent markers in particular cell types, we had to just take whole dorsal root ganglia and then analyze that. But we have mice down the lab that are expressing a fluorescent reporter in neurons that I described before that respond to noxious heat. They express this receptor called the TRPV1 receptor, which is the receptor which responds to noxious heat. And so we were able to drive a fluorescent reporter in the subset of cells. And then Javier used FACS sorting to divide the cells into TRPV1 positive, which are the heat sensing neurons, and then everything else. All the other sensory neurons that don't respond to noxious heat, plus all the non-neuronal cells. And this is the RT-PCR after FACS sorting. And so this was a great result because this gave us two populations of cells that have very different splicing patterns. So this is the TRPV1 expressing cells, and you can see the A exon is expressed there very prominently, but not in all of the other sensory neurons and in the non-neuronal cells. So just in this subpopulation of cells, the detecting noxious heat is this unique splicing pattern. And so we could use those cells to study splicing, which is great. All right. So what does this do, and what's the function? And I mentioned Jessica, who's from La Plata in Argentina, and she joined my lab as a postdoc a number of years ago, and this is a paper from 12 years ago that she published, that she was first author on in Nature Neuroscience, and she showed what the functional importance was of this splicing event. And I'm going to just tell you really quickly, because I already introduced G-protein-coupled receptors, and kind of primed you for this. So what she was looking at was expressing the two different channels in an expression system, and then looking at how G-protein coupled receptors inhibit the activity of these two different isoforms. And remember, this isoform is the one that's really enriched in these subspecialized cells of sensory neurons. Okay? And she also she activated the G-protein couple, not the receptors, but the trimeric G-protein complex, and shows inhibition of the current. This is a calcium current. So this is the ions flowing through that pore that I showed you before, and the ensemble of the current flowing. So when the channels are activated by a change in membrane voltage, current flows. And when the G-protein, trimeric G-protein complex is activated, the current is inhibited from here to here. Great. So that's the B form that's found everywhere in the nervous system. This is classic. It's been studied for many, 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 many years. This is the A form. Only about 13 amino acids different out of over 2,000 between the two channels. So tiny change. Here's the control current. This is the inhibited current. And there's a this there's another part of the current that's strongly inhibited. Okay? So you can see that the profile is different. And what's different between these two is that over here, for the B form, the G beta gamma dimer is binding and inhibiting the channel. And that can be kicked off by strong depolarization. It's a particular type of inhibition. Over here, there are two forms of inhibition. There's the G beta gamma inhibition, which is shown here. But then there's this other inhibitory pathway, which is contributed by G alpha that I talked about earlier, that is only engaged in the A form. So there's a sequence in the A form that is allowing engagement of inhibition through the G alpha pathway. So two forms of inhibition from the G protein signaling pathway for this form, and only one for this form. That's a very significant difference in terms of the way in which the channels are responding to inhibition by G protein coupled receptors, and this is how morphine acts. Okay? So morphine works through this pathway, and what Arturo went on to show is that in the neurons that are expressing these channels, this pathway is engaged only in the heat sensing neurons. And in all other cells, it's just this. Okay. So that enhances the action of morphine in those subset of cells and enhances it relative to all other cells in the dorsal root ganglia. But very cool. So Arturo, so Jessica's work was done in an expression system with clones, but we needed to go into the animal and say, well, let's validate this in the mouse or in an animal looking at neurons, you know, in their natural setting. Okay, can we validate this? And this is what Arturo did. And that was a very challenging set of experiments to try to do because we couldn't separate the two isoforms by the standard pharmacology by toxins because they're both inhibited by the natural toxins that inhibit these channels. They're very difficult to separate. So what Arturo and his colleagues in my lab did was to say, well, look, we need to somehow go into the gene and make a mouse that only expresses one form rather than the wild type that it could express both. And so they did knock-in into the mouse during gene knock-in. This is the wild-type mouse where both forms are expressed, and this is the knock-in mouse, and what they did was they, for the normal A site in the gene, sorry, up here in the gene, they substituted A for B. Okay? So then all the RNAs that are expressed from this mouse contain B. There's no A. So it's gone. They didn't change the intron at all, so splicing can still happen. They just substituted the exons. Great. And then this is the wild-type animal where it could produce A or B. And in those receptors, as I've shown you before, in those heat-sensing nociceptors, both are produced. But in this mouse, only this form is produced. And then they went along and did these beautiful recordings, which Arturo did, and showed that when he looked at the currents in the neurons, he validated Jessica's data that she had in the expression system so that there was a lot stronger inhibition of the calcium currents by opioid receptor activation in the wild type compared to neurons from these knock-in animals that did not express this other exon. So this was a lot reduced in terms of inhibition by that G protein signaling pathway. And the other thing that they did in collaboration with Rachel Jiang is to also look in vivo and look at morphine analgesia in vivo at the spinal cord level and showed that the loss of that exon has an impact on the ability of morphine to inhibit that pathway as well, which was really satisfying because this is, you know, in cell line, in neurons now, and in vivo, really confirming that finding, which is great. Okay. So that was all published. And this is a summary, and I think this should be very straightforward to you now, that two forms in the heat-sensing neurons in dorsal ganglia for the calcium channel, this form found everywhere. The G-protein coupled receptors inhibit the channels through the G-beta-gamma. When this other isoform is expressed, there's a stronger form of inhibition through G-alpha, and this has profound impact on the action of morphine on the channels and in vivo. Great. I will say at the outset, because I think I'll start to run out of time now, when we do nerve injury models in the animal, then this particular isoform decreases dramatically. So the splicing pattern shifts. So there's a lot less of this form and more of this form. And morphine analgesia becomes less effective. This is a very classic observation in the clinic that in chronic pain, morphine becomes less efficacious. Okay? I'm not suggesting this is the only reason, because I think there are multiple, of course there are multiple reasons, but this is one contributor to this very problematic decline in morphine analgesia in chronic pain conditions, okay? All right, so now I'm gonna finish up with a lot of molecular biology. And I do want to do a quick time check because I want to know how much time I have left. So, what do you think? Don't tell me that. Never tell someone on the podium that they have another hour. No, thank you. That makes me feel so much better. Dies. Yes. Yes. That's 100, right? No, I know. It's okay.
But it could be.
It could be. Okay, great. A little light relief. Okay. So I hope that I have convinced you a bit of like splicing is important. It has functional consequences. I've shown you one example. I've shown you this very strong cell-specific expression in a really important part. Every part of the nervous system, of course, is important. But in the part of the nervous system that is important for transmitting information about noxious information, this is a survival mechanism. And that pathway is certainly co-opted and utilized by a number of drugs that are useful in the clinic to alleviate pain. What's the mechanism? Like what's going on at the cellular level? And what are the mechanisms that control this cell-specific event? More generally, I would say that we know very little more generally about how these cell-specific events are actually controlled and regulated in specific cell types. So we thought, well, we have a great opportunity to really be able to follow this path and identify the factors that are driving this cell-specific event, okay? So this is work of Javier, and he and the work that I'm gonna show you for him, we hope will soon be published, but it's not published yet. So this is all unpublished data, and you won't have seen it before. I hope. I don't think so. Yes, you will. If you were there yesterday, you saw it. And you could come up and give this talk. But I won't do that to you. Okay, so if there is, the hypothesis then is that there is a set of proteins or one or two proteins that are driving this cell-specific event. And so a hypothesis we had going into this, this study was that perhaps in TRPV1, I'm using the gene, but these are the temperature sensing neurons. Perhaps in these temperature sensing neurons, there's a protein that binds here and promotes inclusion of this exon, which isn't found in most other parts of the nervous system we've looked at. So there's something helping the spliceosome recognize this site. Or, so we call that an enhancer, or, and that's binding the pre-mRNA, which would be the classic way of thinking about this. Or that in most neurons there's a repressor here, and so spliceosome doesn't recognize this, but recognizes this downstream exon, which is a strong splice junction. It turns out we were half right and half wrong. Yesterday I said I was completely wrong, but I just have to mix it up a bit. But what we thought was that we were looking for proteins that bind the pre-mRNA, and it turns out that we were completely wrong on that. It turned out to be a protein that binds the DNA, genomic DNA, not the pre-mRNA. For those of you who work in this field, you will be surprised by this. I can see the ahs and the wows in the audience. But for those of you who don't, you might say, well, what's the big deal? Well, the big deal is that the processing of the pre-mRNA is at the pre-mRNA, not the genomic DNA. So there's a transcription of the pre-mRNA, and then most of the splicing is occurring at the pre-mRNA level. So how could a protein that binds the genomic DNA control the splicing of the pre-mRNA? Okay. The second big surprise, we were looking for a protein that would only be expressed in those neurons, or not expressed in those neurons, but expressed everywhere else. And we were completely wrong about that too. So maybe mostly wrong. And what I want to stress to you all, for those of you who are doing research and care about being great scientists, follow the data that is showing you that your hypothesis was completely wrong. Because that's where the great discoveries are. And if you ignore those, that will be to your detriment. Because we have limited capacity to be able to make predictions about what is actually going on. And we're usually not right. And so when you do experiments, you should do experiments to test your hypothesis, not to confirm your hypothesis. And when you find data that does not confirm your hypothesis, follow the data, because it's way more interesting and you'll have much more exciting discoveries. Okay? So here's a great example. So I think most of you are not going to know what this plot is, and I don't have time to go into the details, but basically all of this information here is available, freely available to everybody, through the bioinformatics databases that are made publicly available. So we went and looked to see, are there any proteins that bind the exon that we're interested in? And there was this protein called CTCF that binds the genomic DNA right on top of the exon that we were interested in. And these sweeps here are from different human cell lines, just to give you a little anchor. But the point of this slide is that we found in the publicly available database, which you can do too, if you're interested, we can show you how, a protein that binds the exon. And that protein was the very last protein that we ever thought would be important, because it binds the genomic DNA, as I already said, and it is found in every single cell of every single species that's relatively closely related to mammals. And it's in the nucleus, and it controls coordinated gene expression through very early embryogenesis through to adult. And so that was not what we expected. So how could a protein that is found everywhere and binds genomic DNA, how could that be a cell-specific factor that is controlling the splicing in just this one subpopulation of neurons? Okay. So here's the answer. I'm going to show you a couple of data points, and then I'm going to give you the conclusion. So if this was, if this is the case, so Javier, I'm going to skip through a lot of his data, but really get to the crux of the results. He went through a series of experiments to say, well, okay, we need to validate this. Does CTCF bind that locus of the gene in those cells? And the first thing he did was do an in vitro study. Well, first thing we did was look at the sequence. Okay, that's easy. And in the A exon, there's a CTCF binding motif, but it's not present in B, so that already is pretty good. And then he did a gel shift assay, just took A sequence and B sequence, and ran a gel, labeled the probes, the DNA probes, and ran a gel, but added, if you can see in these different columns, recombinant CTCF, an antibody to CTCF, and then a competitive inhibitor, cold competitive inhibitor for the probe. And on your left, you can see this is the A probe, and this is the B, and then on the right, the B probe. And I think this, here's a probe, and you can see a shift in the probe, meaning something bound when CTCF was added. And then there's a super shift when the antibody is added. And then there's no binding of anything in B, meaning that CTCF is binding highly specifically to that particular sequence. That's great. And then he went on and showed that it bound, I'm jumping through experiments to get to kind of I'm going to jump through those experiments that he did in cell lines to go to the experiments he did in the neurons. But through a series of experiments he did looking at the binding of the CTCF, he showed that CTCF does not bind in non-TRPV1 lineage neurons, but it does bind in the TRPV1 lineage neurons, and I'll show you the data in a second. But this is the model. And the trick about the cell specificity was actually that in non-TRPV1 lineage neurons, so where the splicing does not occur, the A exon is methylated. And that prevents the binding of the CTCF. So it's the methylation of the genomic DNA, an epigenetic regulatory mechanism, that is conferring the cell specificity. CTCF binding, of course, impacts the splicing, and I'll tell you about that in a second. So it isn't that the CTCF itself is cell-specific. It's the methylation of a cell-specific methylation of the DNA, which endows the specificity. Okay. And in TRPV1 lineage neurons, this locus is completely unmethylated. There's no methylation. That's very unusual to find sites of total non-methylation. And the non-methylation allows the CTCF to bind. Okay. So just a couple of pieces of data then. If that model is true, then the test of that hypothesis, which was developed based on a lot of different experiments that I skipped over. The test of the hypothesis, and this is the crux of, you know, of testing that hypothesis. Then Javier went in and he sequenced the loci of the A exon in the two different cell populations. You remember right at the beginning I said to you that what Javier showed after fact sorting and just looking at the TRPV1 lineage neurons, that the A exon is included there and not in the non-TRPV1 lineage neurons. Great. So two different populations, different splicing pattern. Then he went in and he did bisulfite sequencing, which actually sequences and shows you where the methylation sites are within the genomic DNA. And this is the result. And it was really stunning. So when he looked in that A locus in these two different cell populations in the TRPV1 lineage and the non-TRPV1 lineage, he showed a completely different pattern of methylation. So here, in the TRIV1 lineage neurons, all these bars here, there are 5 different methylation sites in this locus. None of them are methylated. So these are the open circles. Closed circles represent methylation. And these 20 different lines are independent clones that he isolated and then in sequenced. So these are independent validations of that locus in the cell population. So this is stunning and very satisfying, showing that in the TRIV1 lineage neurons, that site is completely unmethylated, which fits beautifully with the hypothesis that it's methylation that's determining the binding or not of CTCF. And in all other neurons or all other cells, that site is strongly methylated, which prevents CTCF binding and occludes that splicing pattern. And then I'll just say in words that we also did, Javier also did a nerve injury model and showed that this pattern of methylation changes after injury, which is also super interesting because that fits with the model and it also fits with a very dramatic change in the splicing mechanism that he also observed that if you're interested in, I can show you the data later. Question?
How the methylation can change? You show us that the methylation depends on DMT3 that is mostly expressed in development.
Oh, great question.
Neurons don't proliferate, so I don't know how can the methylation of these locus can change in time of
disease. So this is a great question. Sorry, I shouldn't do this and flash these things by you. Okay. So the question is, it's a really good question. Okay, if methylation is the determining factor, then why have I not talked about the DNA methyl transferases that are transferring the methyl group to those substrate sites for methylation, the CpG sites? And I skipped over. But and you're absolutely correct that certain methyl transferases are primarily expressed during development, but others, the DNMT3A, is in fact very prominently expressed in neurons throughout development. And in fact, it's been implicated in the control of methylation under different conditions like neural activity, under stress. So that's actually the DNMT3, the DNMT that is important in regulation of methylation. And so this data I just put up for you was again also very satisfying because we didn't know what we would find when we went in. And so in this experiment, what Javier did was to look to see which, if he knocked down these different methyl transferases, which one would shift splicing. And this is in a cell line. And the only one that shifted splicing was this DNMT3A. So that reduces the methylation, but only when we reduced the activity of DNMT3A did he alter the methylation at that particular site. And that increased the level of A relative to total. So that shifted the splicing pattern. That's a great question, thank you. And then you would also see this is an area you work in, this is the 10-11 translocases here. And so this is promotes demethylation. And similarly, he actually overexpressed the different 10-11 translocases and showed that TET1 and TET2 modify splicing. Yeah. Yes?
Yes. You mentioned that after injury, you express, some cells express more TRP1 or less. But you see a change in the expression.
Yes.
Do the cells after injury, do they express more gene or less
gene? So these are the data after injury. And so it's sorry the writing is small, but I can, if you look down here, so basically here, Javier is looking at how much of the A exon is included in the RNA of the TRPV1 lineage neuron. So he fact sorted. It's actually a really crazy experiment because he has to take the contra and ipsilateral DRG from the lower DRG and then isolate those and post injury and then do the RT-PCR. So, and then do the sequencing. But it was a very powerful data set because this is the ipsilateral DRG, and that's the level of A, and it falls off in every single prep that he did. So the A is decreased dramatically. And this is the showing injury, this is the behavior. But then here actually is the change in the methylation pattern. In the sham control, we just do an incision and no crushing of the nerve. And this is the injury. And you can see in the sham control, there's hypomethylation, nothing's methylated. And after injury, there's increased methylation. So that kind of fits. And to your question about the DNMT3A, it's actually been published by a number of other groups. The DNMT3A increases in this injury model. So that fits pretty nicely. Is that what you were asking? Yeah. Kind of?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, okay. So I already mentioned the people that did the work, and I think you need to move around a little bit, and I can take questions, but I do want to acknowledge, again, the people that did the work that I showed. Javier and Arturo, Jessica, this picture isn't in here. Sorry, Jessica. She'd been in the audience, I would have really made sure I had. But you saw a picture of her earlier. And then Jen Pan was a graduate student even before all of those other people in the lab. And she did chromosome walking in those early days to actually identify that exon. So she's really an amazing scientist. And all of the work that I showed you is funded by the National Institute for Neurological Disease and Stroke, which I'm hugely grateful for their funding, as my lab is. Thank you. I'll take questions. So I don't know what your plan is, but I assume some people aren't going to wait for the Q&A and things, but I don't want to control where people need to be or go. But if you have places to be, please don't hesitate. I won't be offended, but a great part of doing this is to get questions, and so I'm going to start taking questions. Yes, go ahead.
Well, thank you so much for traveling so far away to be here for the first time. And I'd like to say to myself and some of the students that are here who are studying neuroscience, there are some other guys, I think, that are medicine.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And it's the first time that this career is in Mexico and Latin America, which is great. And it's like such a specific career to then specify more. So in your opinion, what would be like talking from a lover of calcium voltage channel, what could we do as neuroscience study students?
Oh, so this is a really, a life question.
I think you're talking about all of your colleagues and how they come from different places to concentrate in one thing.
Yeah.
And at first it was like, I'm a calcium much about drugs and
yes.
about medication. And
yes.
some of these things are really related to medical. Like,
oh. It may be interesting. Good. That was my goal. I achieved it. Excellent. I think when you're starting to think about what should I work on, one always tries to think as far forward as possible and to map what that might look like. And I think it's the same, I gave a kind of a micro level view of that in the research, but you can apply that and scale that kind of to life, which is you may have an expectation or imagine if I do this and I take this path, this is going to be the impact or this is going to be the influence that I will have. You have no idea. I don't mean you, I mean the royal we have no idea. And so that's a little scary sometimes, but it's also really exciting often. And so I think as much as we can, make good decisions about what we would work on and try and follow where the challenges are, I would say that would be the advice. Don't pick the easy route because you're going to get bored really quickly. Pick that route that is, you think, I'm not sure that I can get there, but I'm definitely going to try, and I think that you can then move into areas that you would just be completely unexpected. I mean, I started, as you pointed out, really quite astutely. When I started out, I was really focused on synaptic transmission, actually, and biophysics. And I was in a very strong biophysics group and pharmacology at University College London. So that was just the most amazing thing. Patch clamp had just been invented. Wow. That was like everyone was so super excited about being able to see the single molecules and the channels like opening and closing. And we'd just read about in textbooks, and then suddenly you go into the Journal of Physiology and like there's some recordings, like that's amazing. Everyone's like, are they going to be square? Are they gonna, like, what are they going to look like? And suddenly someone records them and you know what they look like. So I followed that path of trying to stay, in areas that was kind of like the leading points of whatever field, I ended up in. And you're absolutely right. It's not till later, actually, maybe years later, that in the entirety of the work that you start to do, you see these connections, and then you start to make the connections, and then it's not till later that you're able to design experiments that actually connect those different pieces. So I'd say do the thing that's most challenging. Definitely do neuroscience. Well, most people here are interested in that, unless, you're in med school and you had to come to this lecture, but you're not really interested in it. But like, I think most people, are really super keen on neuroscience, and it's really a challenging field. And, we know this much about this much. And so, you all, mostly young faces in this audience, like you're going to be really the trailblazers. You're going to really make the massive discoveries. And so I'd love to be you sitting there right now, like with like this whole amazing discovery kind of laying in front of you. So I think that's it. Like, I don't know. That was a long answer to your question, but it's a really good one.
Really important opinion of what science and education.
Yeah, it's so important. Yeah, it's so important. It's the only route to cures of diseases and therapies. And we really don't know enough to make really good plans about that yet. Yep. Question, yeah. Sorry, yep. Maybe I'll take you first and then can I move back to you since, yeah. Great.
You briefly talked about imagination, but you never mentioned what caused the imagination. And like, if it's imagination in the universe, then you could reactivate those. So what helped?
Yeah. Did you hear the question? And I can repeat it if you didn't. Again, great questions. So I very fleetingly said demethylation and then not much else. And so the question is, what is that? Like, and so there are a family of enzymes that are called the 10-11 translocases, and they promote demethylation of the CpG sites. And so Javier looked at those and identified a couple of family members that regulate that locus. But your question might be a little bit more deeper, which is, okay, so you climb the pyramid, which I think we're going to do on Sunday. Yeah, okay, good. So, you know, you start with an observation, you climb the pyramid, and you're like, okay, what controls the splicing, what controls CTCF, what controls the methylation? And then what controls the methylated enzymes and the demethylated enzymes? And we don't know the top of the pyramid. We don't know. We wish we knew. We don't know. One experiment I zipped by, and I don't know if you were quick enough to catch it, but one thing that we are thinking about very hard is, look, this isn't global change in the methylation and demethylation enzymes. It couldn't be. We're trying to really think very hard about what is localizing those enzymes to that locus. The hypothesis is something is carrying those enzymes, maybe the demethylated enzymes in the TRPV1 lineage neurons. Maybe there's a molecule that's carrying the TETs to that locus. There are a number of molecules that are possible. The long non-coding RNAs do have cargo. And so maybe, you know, maybe there's a complementary to certain long non-coding RNAs that take that cargo to that locus. But our goal right now is to try to understand exactly how there is very local demethylation, hypomethylation of that locus, which is unusual. And we think we know the balance of the enzymes that might be causing it, but we do not know. How are they really specifically regulating methylation at that particular locus? It's kind of a really important enzyme. We did use Cas9, he did use Cas9, deactivated Cas9 to carry the cargo. And got a really beautiful result. So we know if you localize the enzymes, then you can see a change in splicing. Yeah. So there's a question here and then here and over here. Great.
My question is just about that.
Yeah.
Do you think that
there is like a group of genes that are demethylated in this phenomenon, or there is just this locus that, and if this a group of genes that it could be regulated by a transcription factor that it's binding to a specific thing, or as you said, long no coding RNAs, or what's your hypothesis? Thank you.
Yeah, great. So Javier actually has a really prestigious fellowship to follow up on exactly that. And so your Your question is certainly the way in which we're currently thinking, that this is the tip of the pyramid, which is that we think it is extremely likely that this is one of a number of genes whose splicing is coordinated in those cells. You know, certainly other parts of the nervous system as well. And so Javier is setting up to do a lot of sequencing, a lot of transcriptome analysis, because having that differential cell population is just, it's a dream. It's a lot of dissection and fax routine, but it's like really makes those experiments so much easier to actually do and interpret. It's exactly what we're thinking. Exactly your question. Yeah, great, thanks.
La segunda parte de la presentación nos acompaña Kristin Webster.
Oh.
Up you come. Javier López Soto. Ellos, Kristin, está haciendo su postdoctorado, como ya lo escuchamos de la doctora Doyan, y trabaja como coordinadora en educación en el Brown. Y Javier es recipiente del premio World Albert Fellowship, y nos compartirá sus experiencias sobre el procedimiento para hacer estancias, doctorados o postdoctorados y becas internacionales, así como estrategias en la transición a dirigir un programa de investigación. Entonces ellos harán un poquito de experiencia. Pero antes de darles el micrófono, quisiéramos entregarles un título. Por la excelente conferencia.
Hola.
Hola, mi nombre es Javier.
Ella es Kristin.
So we were wondering if you have any questions, or if you are planning to move abroad to have a postdoc experience. So,
well, how many people in the audience are undergraduates? Just help us get a sense. Okay. Graduate students? Quite a few. Any postdocs? Any people thinking about doing a postdoc? Okay. Excellent. So, as they said, I actually did my PhD in Dr. Lipscomb's lab, and then I left and did a postdoc for 3 years at the Laboratory of Molecular Biology in Cambridge, England, before returning to work in Diane's lab and the Kearney Institute for Brain Science at Brown.
So, and I'm from Argentina. I did my PhD in Jessica Rengel's lab, as you saw during the presentation. And then I moved to Diane's lab 4 years ago. So I'm a postdoc, I'm a senior postdoc in her lab. And recently I got awarded with this fellowship, which is kind of cool. So they are supporting a lot of our research, and that's going to allow us to do sequencing to kind of answer one of the questions that you already asked about how many genes are involved, are disrupted in the splicing after nerve injury. So, and yeah, well, like for me, maybe I can tell you that at the beginning, I think the hardest part of moving outside of Argentina was the cultural shock. I was very fortunate and lucky that I arrived to a really welcoming community at Brown, And I think that's something that you need to be sure that where you're getting, if you're thinking about going abroad, the place where you're going to work for at least a year, it has to be welcoming, it has to be friendly. So if you can get like many insight from many people that have been working there, that's very important. And of course the science, right? It's something that you have to think about that. But you like the science is important because that will be your professional career, but you're spending a lot of time in the lab.
The lab matters.
Right.
The lab environment, the people that you're working with matter. So even if you love the experiments, if you can't work with your colleagues, it's going to be a challenge. So when you go on interviews for graduate school or for postdocs, don't just talk to the PI, talk to the students, talk to the people. Do they talk to each other in the hallway, right? Are the labs friendly? Do they have tea time together? It might not seem intuitive, but these things will actually give you a lot of insight into the community, I think.
Yes. I also think it's very important if the lab is very collaborative with other labs and with people inside the lab. I have many friends working in different labs across the US, and I'm seeing different styles. So I think I've been also very lucky because we have many collaborations with different labs inside Brown University and also outside, which allows us to actually learn a lot. For example, we have a publication with C. elegans, and I don't work with C. elegans, but we have the chance to kind of learn about that system, or with Drosophila, and I don't work with Drosophila, we work with mice or hex cells. So I think that's very important to increase your background, your training, and also have more analytical way to see the science.
I actually switched model organisms between graduate school and my postdoc. I went from working in Diane's lab with cell lines to actually a C. elegans lab because I wanted to do invertebrate electrophysiology. So definitely be open to where the science leads you and ask yourself how best to answer your questions. You know, is a different organism or a different approach really a better way to answer what you're most curious about? So don't be afraid to switch, to learn new things, to ask for help, to ask people to teach you things.
Yeah. One of the reasons that I moved to Diane's lab is because she offered me these kind of tools and resources and people to learn with new things. So during my grad studies in Argentina, I did a lot of batch clamp. And my goal was to kind of absorb many other, you know, subfields in neuroscience, molecular neuroscience, but also bioinformatic behavior. And as you can see, like in the second part of Diane's talk, we did a lot of pain essays in behavior and sequencing and molecular biology. And that was my goal, not only offer something that I was kind of solid and I was confident that I can offer to the lab, but also I wanted to take something from the lab for me, for my training and education.
I mean, we can certainly keep talking about graduate school and postdocs, but if you have questions, we'd certainly be happy to speak to specific concerns or areas you're curious about.
Yep. Thank you very much for listening to a very nice talk. This is like facility for telling the story. The students that are here just came here to see you. And they have a lot of questions about the stays, short stays, or probably opportunities to come to and collaborate in the future. So I would like to thank Los Angeles students for this opportunity, and it's really much think about the questions.
Thank you.
Well, hi.
First of all, I really like to, well, I would really like to thank you both and also Diane for this opportunity. And my question is about, well, I know you've been talking about postdoc stays and all that kind of chances, but I wanted to ask if there's any opportunity for us undergraduates to maybe like get a little more involved in the world you like know now?
Ah, that's an excellent question. I guess I could answer it from the Carney perspective. So Brown University does have exchange programs and opportunities for undergraduates to come visit for a semester. And there are some more formal partnerships for certain universities. That is something that if the university could explore, maybe more than just individual students. But I know there are opportunities for undergraduates to do like semesters or to do exchanges or even to come for a summer and do research in someone's lab.
And my other question was like maybe for further notice, how did you guys got support like for Diane to pay attention to you? Like how did you get to her lab? Like what did you do to get there?
I think we're going to have very different answers. So I was already accepted into the Brown Neuroscience graduate program. And Diane was one of my faculty. She was lecturing for my courses as a first-year graduate student. And I'll admit, I never thought I was going to be an electrophysiologist. That was not what I came to graduate school to do. But I really respected her and her work and was really interested in the topic. And I was very interested in mental health. And as she alluded to, I actually worked on a project that was completely different from what still a voltage-gated calcium channel, but a different one from the rest of the lab. And that one actually has some SNPs in it that are associated with major psychiatric disease. And so there was an opportunity for me to follow something I was passionate about. And she was excited that I was excited about this other project. And so I asked, I sent an email. I said, can I rotate in your lab? And she said, yes. You'd be surprised how much you can get just by asking. At least my experience with most professors is they're there to teach you and they're there to help and they're there to mentor, but you just have to ask. Not everyone's gonna say yes, but if you ask enough times, someone will. And so just keep asking. And I asked if I could rotate, and I think it was a mutually good experience, and I chose to stay.
So my experience was a little bit different, and coming back to your first question, I think Fulbright also offers short stays to go to the US. I don't know exactly how that works, but I know that they have some short stays for the US. And so it's a little bit, as you saw during the presentation, so my PhD advisor is Diane, it was Diane's postdoc too. So we have like this family. and I was like really aware of Diane's work and all her work and Arturo's work too. So when I started to apply to postdoc positions abroad, so I sent emails to Europe, in the US mostly, and it's hard to get like emails back from the PIs. So don't take that personally, because they have many things to do. So I started to send like the same email, you know, to the same person, till at least I said, I'm busy, I don't know. I was like, you know, you get so anxious about it. And I was like in contact with Diane and saying, well, this is my focus of interest. This is what I want to do. And at that moment, she got a grant that involved all this project and these techniques. And when she shared it with me, I said, well, this is perfect, because I really want to learn something that I wasn't in contact here in Argentina, when I was in Argentina, right? So it was a great match in that way, you know? Yeah, so that's...
I actually have a similar story, well, a related story for how I not got Diane's attention, but my eventual postdoc advisor's attention, and that's use your mentors and use your network. The head of my thesis committee for our program is not your actual advisor. So I had another mentor, whose name is Dr. Ann Hart. And she knew that I was interested in moving into an invertebrate field for my postdoc, and she also worked in C. elegans. So at the Society for Neuroscience conference, I went to one of her socials that she was hosting called the Crunchies and Squishy Social, because it's for the invertebrate people. And so I went, and I was this, you know, very scared grad student in a room full of what felt like very important researchers. And I had gone with the goal of, I'm going to talk to someone about possible postdocs. And then I completely chickened out. I was like, I don't want. I was like, no, no, they're all catching up. They're talking to their friends. They don't want to talk science right now. And I'm so thankful that Anne was there, because she came over to me when I was like in the corner talking to another grad student. She said, Kristen, have you talked to anyone yet? And I said, no, I don't want to bother them. And she said, well, that's nonsense. And she very loudly started pointing at people in the room, going, he works on this. She works on that. He's in Texas. Oh, do you want to move to Texas? I don't know. And I was just like, oh, they could hear you. But she eventually pointed to Dr. Bill Schaefer, who became my postdoc advisor, and she said, oh, he works in Cambridge, England. And I went, ooh, that sounds fun. And she went, actually, he needs a physiologist for a postdoc. And she grabbed my hand, and she dragged me over to him, interrupted his conversation, and put her hands on my ears and said, Bill, this is Kristen. She's one of the nice, hardworking ones you want in your lab, and just walked away. And I was just like, thanks. And he just looked at me and went, so you need a postdoc. What do you do? And that conversation changed my life. So I'm very thankful to her for that. But you have to ask your mentors, who's in their network? Who do you think I would be interested in? Where do you think I would be a good fit? Who do they know that they can make an introduction for you? Use your networks and use your mentors to meet the people that you are interested in meeting.
I think I have a very interesting point. I also, what I like working, at least in Diane's lab, and I know this is not the case in any labs, and you should be very careful when you, is about how rigorous they are when they're doing science. The data, but like, especially when you're doing your own experiment, just be aware that not many labs are very rigorous, and I think that's something important to build, you know, science in a better way.
You're next.
Hello. Thank you very much. And I have a question about once you're a graduate student and you are you have you have some opportunities to do the research with people in your network, as you said, and the research that is being done at the time. And how do you guys find balance between those opportunities that you have and like maybe the research that you dream of doing, and maybe growing your network is also a factor? How do you know when to take, let's say, a post or a research position, balancing that with other things that like you want to do or you want to research, maybe like calcium channels, like it's what's hot, you got right now, and how do you link that with your other research or what you want to do in the future?
So if I understand correctly, you're asking if I'm interested in something completely different than my project. That's what you're asking.
Well, maybe not completely different, but do you have like a way where you personally find a balance between what you can do and what you want to do, or what you wish you could do?
Yeah, I think like if you, when you choose a lab, right, like you kind of like fit in like the field that the lab is working, right? That's the reason that you're going there. And usually there is some flexibility, right? Like during my, when I'm leading this project, is like I started to think about, oh, how methylation was regulated, and it's not something that we thought at the beginning when we started the project. So there are things that start to show up during, you know, when you are working during your project, and I think when you are a postdoc, you kind of have like, you have to take the decision, okay, I'm going this way because I think this is interesting, or I'm going to this other way. And then you have to convince your PI saying, this is very interesting because of this or because of that. You know, you need to have reasons to be like using resources for that. At least that's the way that I think, you know, and be supported with papers, and if you can get some preliminary data, that's even better. Yeah.
Yeah, I would say as you progress, you gain more independence and more control over the experimental design and what you choose to work on. And I think if you have preliminary data, if you can go to the head of the lab and say, you know, this is really compelling. It's what Diane was talking about. Follow the science. If, you know, you have something that's interesting and you think that's worth pursuing, you know, we're not suggesting you use side resources to pursue something different, but use the data to make the argument that that's the, I guess, direction that you should be going in. You're in someone else's lab, but you are an independent scientist, and they want you thinking about experimental design and about context and how these experiments fit into the larger picture. So I think it almost comes down to science communication and thinking about the larger picture and how it fits, and really being able to convince the more senior scientists in your group that that's worth following. Does that answer your question?
So I'm almost finished my biomedical degree, mm-hmm. and I look the science field, and it's kind of scary. Like, you are in this super prestigious university, and I'm like, how do I get there, you know? Like, what I have to do to be there? And also, okay, I finished my degree, my PhD, postdoctoral, whatever, and what's next? Like, I know I want to do science all my life. I love science, I love neuroscience, but I don't think this is a common topic with my colleagues. Like, this is like not a very, you know, like you are always here and there, and you're not stable. Mm-hmm. So what do you think about that? What I should look for in the future for me, or wait, all of us?
Sorry, Cedric, quick question. No, let me just rephrase to make sure. So it's kind of, how do you get to the next step, and how do you make the transitions to the places that you want to go, and how do you, I guess, balance that? Because an academic life can be a transient life, right? You're in graduate school and you may go somewhere else for a postdoc, and then you apply for faculty or research positions, and they could be all over. So there is a certain amount of flexibility, I guess, required when you're making choices about where to go to graduate school, where to postdoc. Frequently, things more than just what science are they doing weigh in on the decision, right? Not everyone can move internationally for various reasons, or even across the country. So that certainly does factor into the position or into the decisions. But it might sound silly, but I think the best thing I can say is do good science. And if you do good science, regardless of where you are, and then you talk to your colleagues who are doing similar science, like, that will speak for itself. That will be your ticket to the next thing. It really struck me yesterday when we were walking around some of the labs how just universal science is. You know, I was in a lab and I was like, we have that equipment, they're doing Western blots. Like, it was so familiar. I felt like even though I was in a different country, in a different lab, I could sit down and just start doing experiments if I had to. So in that sense, like, although there's lots of cultural changes that come with moving internationally, maybe, or even to a different program, the science will be the consistent thing. And that really should be what carries you through. Because if you do good science, people will recognize that, especially with when you look at the resources that you were doing it with. I'm not sure if that answers things.
Yeah, the only thing that I have to say about that is, like, we always like to be comfortable. You know, like, I remember when I was doing my PhD, it's like, I don't want to look for a postdoc. I'm fine here, you know? Like, I know what I have to do, keep doing this. But then it finished, and then you have to move, you know, and be in a place that you don't know exactly what's going on. Like, in another country if you can, or like in a different lab. But I think it's like it's the way to do it, and it's good to do it. You know, it's like it's good to move forward and have that experience, because that's when you learn. You know, doing the same thing over and over again, there is a point that you just can't learn more. And you need to leave the people that you've been working and move to another lab, change a little bit the field if you can, or expand your training. I think those things are scary. I'm not saying that they're not. And probably you're gonna make a lot of mistakes because that's the learning process, right? But yeah, I think the best thing is just go and do it and have fun as much as you can. Yes.
Well, thank you. I want to know if you would recommend starting grad school right away when you finish your college, but in another country, if you think that's a good thing to do.
So I did go to graduate school straight out of undergraduate. And so I had some undergraduate research experience, although I wouldn't say I had it necessarily as intense as it was in graduate school. So that was a bit of a surprise for me. I adapted. It worked out. I might have benefited from a year doing research between, but it worked out in the end. It's never bad to have more research experience, I would say, certainly when applying. Moving to another country for graduate school, I mean, that's up to you. It depends on what you're looking for in a program, and I think it's more about finding a program that fits and people that you want to work with.
I'm not sure about how it could be. I mean, I just jumped. So I was like studying in Argentina, so the system is different there. So I finished the bachelor degree, and then I just went directly to the PhD without any time in the middle. I know that people in the US, they take 1 year to do some research, like tiny research projects.
Or 1 or 2 years working as a lab tech is now very common in the States before applying to graduate school, or doing like a post-bac program,
yeah.
Post-baccalaureate. So it's not uncommon, but a lot of people, you see both, I suppose. It's really a question of how prepared do you feel like you are for graduate school research-wise, and how competitive are you? The more research experience you have before applying, I think the more competitive you'll be. So if you have your sights set on a really prestigious program, you might need more experience before being able to get, anyone might need more experience before getting in.
And also, like, from the personal side, like, if you're not sure if you like a field, like, or some lab or some program, maybe it would be good to be, you know, go there, work for a year, and see if you like it, if you fit with that kind of science or what the work that science required, and then take your decision, kind of to double confirm that.
Okay. Hi, I like research, but I also know that I don't want to do it. But specifically in my case, I would love to, for example, prepare the future researchers. So I'm interested in teaching. And I wonder how the system works, for example, at Brown. Because in here, for programs like this, teaching positions for our type of classes are designated for people who do research on that area. So it's the same over at Brown?
So to teach at the university level in the States, or at least at Brown, That does require a PhD. However, and most of our undergraduate classes are taught by professors who have research labs. However, there are a few positions that I would call like a full-time lecturer position, where we have two specifically just in the neuroscience department, and their job is 100% to teach undergraduates some of the more fun elective neuroscience courses. So I think there is recognition in the states right now that we're training more PhDs than we have lab space for, that not everyone who's earning a PhD is going to be a professor or a researcher with their own lab. And so there's a big push for professional development for graduate students and for postdocs to do more with their PhDs, to get teaching experience, to get industry experience, policy, public engagement, science communication. I think there's a movement towards supporting what used to be called alternative careers, and we're trying to get away from that phrase in the States now. But I would say there are definitely avenues at Brown to get a PhD in research, but use your degree and still be engaged with the science, but not running your own lab. Well, also, yes, if you don't like research, then graduate school is a really long time doing a bunch of research.
Les vamos a tomar a todos una foto, no se muevan. Después de esta foto les voy a suplicar que retiren de la zona donde se sentaron las servilletas y los vasitos, todas las fotos propias del auditorio, para que guardemos el respeto a los chicos. Gracias. ¿Les puedo pedir que se quiten los lentes?
No one works on it. They won't believe
it. I'm sorry. Ahora de este lado para que se ponga la
now on the other side.
Can you quote
Javier?
More pictures.
¿Puedes?
Sí.
Sí.